we will defend the flag of the United States of America.
Even though some Democrats are co-sponsoring the Bush Amendment, a spokesman for the Democratic Party said the heroes of Iwo Jima didn't die so they could become a backdrop for some political photo opportunity.
Our purpose today transcends politics and partisanship.
But Senate Minority Leader Bob Dole did suggest there are political risks in voting against the amendment.
To those members of Congress and to those state legislatures who may not like this amendment, may feel that the amendment is not necessary, I simply say this: vote against the amendment. Voice your opposition.
The proposed amendment simply prohibits the physical desecration of the flag of the United States. Critics say that language is open to abuse.
When Mrs. Bush wears one around her neck in the form of a scarf, is that a desecration? When someone puts it on a poster, or when commercial advertisers put it on bumper stickers or coffee mugs, is that a desecration?
Civil rights leaders at the White House today sharply scolded Mr. Bush for not moving at all to undo other Supreme Court decisions weakening civil rights laws.
The president did not mention the Supreme Court decisions one time in his remarks. The reality is, so far, they have put flag rights over workers' rights, over basic civil rights.
But when it comes to the flag, other Democrats remember what happened to Michael Dukakis in the campaign.
There is no partisan difference on this issue.
But it has become political. Democrats and Republicans will undoubtedly spend this 4th of July vying over who loves the American flag more. Leslie Stahl, CBS News, the White House.
Polish Communist Party leader Wojciech Jaruzelski, understanding the political realities in his country, announced today he will not run for president. Bert Quint explains.
Youths who want no deal with the communists clashed with police on the streets of Warsaw today. They demanded that party chief Wojciech Jaruzelski give up his plan to take over the powerful new post of president of Poland. They didn't know it, but they were fighting a battle that was already won. Tonight, in a statement read on national television that sounded like his political swan song, Jaruzelski admitted he doesn't have public support. He said he would not be a candidate for president. Party faithfuls asked him to reconsider. But these youngsters and millions of other Poles remember Jaruzelski as the man who crushed Solidarity in 1981. For them, the fact that he allowed the union to become legal again this year and opened the door to Polish democracy isn't enough. With his support in the Communist Party weakened by the humiliating defeat by Solidarity in the parliamentary election, Jaruzelski recommended another general for the job, the Interior Minister, Czesław Kiszczak. During martial law, Kiszczak had jailed many of Solidarity's new parliamentarians. But recently, he gained Solidarity's respect as the regime's key man at the roundtable talks that drew up the blueprint for Polish democracy. The union intends to keep its word and let a communist become president, not just because that was the deal, but because it doesn't want the responsibility and the risks of trying to run the country while the army, the police, and the bureaucracy remain in communist hands. Bert Quint, CBS News, Warsaw.
In Seoul, South Korea today, a nasty battle between police and student demonstrators who carried with them not only pipes, rocks, and firebombs, but strong anti-American sentiment. As Bill Whitaker reports, that feeling leads some Americans to question why U.S. military support should continue.
Thousands of South Korean riot police clashed with radical students today, many chanting anti-American slogans. It was one of the most violent confrontations in recent years. Scores were injured. The students had planned to defy the government and attend a youth rally in communist North Korea. After a 40-year alliance against the North, a growing anti-Americanism is taking root here in the South, especially among those too young to remember the Korean War. And now the banner is being picked up by a growing number of workers and farmers. Hundreds of villagers attacked the U.S. bombing range at Kuni this spring. Later, they stormed the base, trapping 10 airmen in this room for more than an hour before help arrived.
We had locked all the doors, and they had come through one of the windows, and we could hear them destroying things.
On the streets of Seoul, where U.S. troops have been warned it's hazardous to be seen in uniform, servicemen are resentful.
We've been over here since, you know, the Korean War, trying to help these people, help defend their country and everything for them. And I don't think they appreciate it.
I'm over here on a mission, and they don't want us here. Hey, I would rather go home.
All of this comes at a time when the U.S. Senate is considering a bill to cut American forces here and have South Korea pay more for its own defense.
Now that they have an economy seven times the size of the North Koreans and over twice the population, certainly they're more than capable of defending themselves.
President Roh says South Korea needs continued U.S. military support.
There is a saying in America, if it ain't broke, don't fix it. And I think it neatly applies to this situation.
The military alliance isn't broken yet, but there are cracks in the foundation, and they seem to be growing wider. Bill Whitaker, CBS News, Seoul.
Chinese leaders continue to rewrite history today. This time, a new version of that deadly night troops attacked student demonstrators. But one of the students who escaped to the U.S. has a different story. Richard Roth in New York has more.
This is to be the last day Tiananmen Square will look like this. Tomorrow, Chinese authorities plan to give it back to the Chinese people and fill it with tourists, almost a month after the army took it over in a brutal assault. And again today, the government revised its account of what happened. At a parliamentary meeting, Beijing's mayor said more than 200 civilians were killed in Beijing during the military crackdown on the democracy movement, more than double the number authorities had previously admitted. The mayor said the dead that night included 36 college students, and official reports by the Chinese press said the mayor added a chilling commentary to his revised account of casualties. Those who died, he said, deserved it. Outside Boston today, a student leader who escaped the carnage said the official story is still a lie. Shen Tong, a Beijing University biology student, now on China's most wanted list, said he was west of the square when troops and tanks rolled by, shooting indiscriminately into the crowd.
Today, I'm protesting in the strongest terms. The bloody suppression of the democratic movement by the Chinese government.
Civilians couldn't believe the army would fire on them, he said, so they didn't move fast enough. Shen said he fled China a week after the crackdown on a commercial airline flight, one of a handful of dissidents vowing to keep their movement alive in exile.
The future belongs to our generation. The seed of democracy has been sown.
Another symbol of China's free expression movement appeared in the West today, another exile from Beijing. A model of the statue from Tiananmen Square, sculpted in a New York studio by Wang Shugang, who designed the original. This is smaller, but its meaning is unchanged, says the artist. It's still a symbol of freedom and democracy and the hopes of the Chinese people. Richard Roth, CBS News, New York.
Still to come on the CBS Evening News, Susan Spencer on new rules to let overworked hospital interns get some sleep. And Richard Schlesinger on a mild-mannered accountant who just might be D.B. Cooper. Back in court today for Oliver North, his motion for a mistrial was denied. His Iran-Contra trial conviction on three felony counts still stands. North's lawyers moved for a mistrial on grounds the jury member, Tara King, failed to disclose in a pretrial questionnaire that she had family members involved in court cases, including a brother convicted of robbery. Federal Judge Gerhard Gesell ruled today this in no way denied North a fair trial. It clears the way for North's sentencing July 5th. He's facing up to 10 years in prison and a $750,000 fine. The Inspector General of the Department of Housing and Urban Development told Congress today he began warning of major problems in HUD spending policies in 1985. Inspector General Paul Adams said HUD officials called his recommendations too strict. CBS News Washington correspondent Terrence Smith reports tonight on one of the central figures in the still unfolding HUD investigation, Deborah Gore Dean. She reportedly had a major say in doling out taxpayer dollars by the millions, but now won't say what she did.
This woman has time on her hands after taking the Fifth Amendment against possible incrimination in the spreading scandal at the Department of Housing and Urban Development. Congressional and federal investigators want to know how, at the age of 33 and with few qualifications, she was able to dispense hundreds of millions of dollars in government subsidies to well-connected Republicans. The head of the huge agency during the Reagan years was Samuel Pierce, dubbed Silent Sam. If he was an absentee landlord at HUD, who was really in charge?
My name is Deborah Gore Dean, D-E-A-N.
And when consultants and developers needed a favor at HUD, who did they contact?
Well, I called Miss Dean.
Deborah Dean.
Miss Dean, as the chief of staff, was involved in the process.
An improbable power broker, Miss Dean's jobs before the government included tending bar at several Georgetown watering holes.
Well, I first met Debbie when she was managing the Guards restaurant on M Street in Georgetown back in the late 70s.
It was a privileged childhood as the daughter of an old-line Republican Maryland family who spent 8 years as an undergraduate at Georgetown University. But her entree to the top ranks of the Reagan administration was the man she called her stepfather, the late convicted Watergate figure John Mitchell. Mitchell lived with Miss Dean's widowed mother.
She not only got to HUD, but climbed the ladder because of extensive political contacts at the very highest level.
Bart Naylor investigated Deborah Dean's background for a Senate committee when she was nominated to be promoted to Assistant Secretary of HUD in 1987.
She was, in fact, abusing her government-issued credit card for personal expenses. She asked for money from her employees, and these were for not just $5 and $10 lunch money tabs, but for thousands of dollars. We talked to subordinates who said that they were asked to do a number of things, clean her apartment, paint her apartment. This was on, if you will, company time.
Well, I thought she wasn't qualified at all. She was somebody who learned, she maybe not learned much about housing, but she learned a lot about networking, about helping people and having people help her and getting as much power and authority as she could get.
That nomination was withdrawn, but Ms. Dean wielded extensive power as executive assistant to Secretary Pierce.
She was very definitely someone who, whether in true, whether in truth or perception, spoke for the secretary.
Miss Dean was supposed to make the decisions herself. She was a member of the committee. She was to use her own intelligence in making these decisions.
And she may well have to answer for those decisions in public. Dean's attorneys are currently negotiating the terms under which she will testify before the congressional committee investigating the HUD scandal. Terrence Smith, CBS News, Washington.
Republican Congressman Donald Lukens of Ohio was sentenced today to 30 days in jail and fined $500. Lukens was convicted on a misdemeanor charge for having sex with a 16-year-old girl. Lukens has resisted calls for his resignation, saying he intends to keep his House seat and keep appealing his conviction. Another glum report on the economy today. The Commerce Department said factory orders dropped 2.5% in May, the sharpest decline in 10 months. Analysts said the manufacturing slowdown could push the Federal Reserve Board into lowering interest rates to spark economic activity. There will be a major change in hospital care tomorrow in New York State. It may point the way to similar changes in hospitals around the country. Medical correspondent Susan Spencer reports.
Just take a few deep breaths for me, okay? Mouth open.
In most hospitals, it's the interns and residents who do daily patient care. Doctors in training who may have been working 30 hours or more.
I've had times where I've fallen asleep listening to a patient's heart on a new admission and just kind of didn't move until the patient woke me up.
You look at your patients as the enemy. They're keeping you here longer. You haven't slept in a day and a half.
But medicine has long defended 36-hour days and 100-hour work weeks as educational, the way new doctors see an illness progress, assuming they still can see anything.
If you've been up all night, you're going to nod off a bit. There's no doubt about it.
I wouldn't wish my internship on a dog.
Tomorrow, New York becomes the first state to limit the hours of residents and interns, limit them, that is, to a mere 80 hours a week. Its new rules also call for greater supervision. The changes were prompted not so much by complaints from overworked staff as by one tragic and much publicized event, the case of Libby Zion, who died at New York Hospital one night in 1984, just hours after being admitted for a high fever. Died, her parents have charged, because of incompetent care by an exhausted resident and intern.
This is not just Libby Zion. Libby Zion is simply one of hundreds of cases that have occurred and continue to occur.
The case of Libby Zion may have made change inevitable, but it's not made it easy. The hospitals are searching frantically for more nurses and support staff to the tune of a $226 million subsidy from the state.
If there's a patient care benefit, it will be welcomed. At this moment, it's difficult to forecast, and it is an expensive change.
Intuitively, I would think that these kinds of regulations are indeed a good thing, but are they still a good thing if they cost clearly $250 million a year?
The answer will depend on the future quality of patient care. Will patients really benefit from better supervised, more rested doctors? Certainly the doctors expect to benefit. Since the announcement of the changes, medical students from around the country have expressed new interest in training in New York. Susan Spencer, CBS News, Washington.
A group of army officers seized power in Sudan today, suspended the constitution, and arrested leaders of the civilian government. They blamed the elected officials for failing to end a six-year-old civil war. Lived in Detroit in the late 1950s. Today, it's estimated that number may have dropped as low as 90,000. And so, because of declining attendance, the Detroit Archdiocese began closing 31 churches at the beginning of the year. However logical, those closings bring pain and bewilderment. Gary Reeves was in Detroit today as two more churches shut down.
At St. Augustine, they carted the crucifix off to storage. At St. Philip, there was a tearful last mass as Detroit's Catholics mourn the closing of 31 churches, once the center of the city's spiritual life.
It's just like a mother. You're with her all your life, and then when she dies, you're lost.
Where will those people go that live around here? They have no place to go.
Many of the Baroque churches were built by immigrants, but as their descendants moved away, church membership dwindled by 90%. The Detroit Archdiocese claims closing a fourth of the city's churches is the only choice.
If you have them join another parish that already has some strength, the social efforts that community makes can be much stronger.
Touch our cardinal's heart.
The parishioners challenge the archbishop's authority by picketing his house, but appeals to the Vatican and to a local judge were all turned down, leaving wounds that are slow to heal.
I'm shocked and angered and embarrassed for our church that there isn't a more equitable way to do this kind of thing.
Now we are told that we're not important anymore, and that's not what Christianity is about.
People feel that they've been so abandoned in this that many of them are leaving the church.
The church has pledged to continue programs for the poor, the soup kitchens and the food pantries the inner city depends on. But the priest, like Father Don Walker, will be reassigned.
I'm sad to leave here because the people of these streets are my brothers and sisters and have been for a long time.
Now the closed churches are up for sale, priced from $15,000 to $500,000 each. And the Baptists, now Detroit's leading denomination, are already buying.
The good Lord had looked down on us and just gave us blessing that we didn't even think we were going to get.
For Detroit's 90,000 Catholics, the troubles may not be over. While 89 city churches remain open, 24 of them must show substantial growth in the next year, or they too will be closed. Gary Reeves, CBS News, Detroit.
Five people died today and dozens suffered injuries when a fire touched off by a series of explosions sent smoke rolling through a 10-story office building in downtown Atlanta. Officials said workers smashed windows with chairs and a woman jumped from the sixth floor. The fire apparently was started by an explosion which occurred when a fuse was being repaired shortly after a power failure.
What's that?
Common Sense Oat Bran.
Common Sense should tell you it takes these four boxes to equal the vitamin and mineral nutrition in just one box of Total.
That makes no sense. How about 100% natural?
How about 16 boxes?
How about enough is enough?
Total, one bowl, 100%. That's more nutrition than any other cereal.
Now that makes a whole lot of sense.
If it's whole wheat Total, it's total nutrition.
Hot tea all day doesn't stop this denture wearer from hitting high C.
Hot tea? Fix it and forget it.
Give up hot chocolate just because I started wearing dentures? Uh-uh. Scab!
Hot chocolate? Fix it and forget it. Heat-resistant Fixident spreads evenly to keep on fixing loose spots, no matter how often it gets hot.
I can drink hot coffee all day and still help a lady.
Heat-resistant. One more reason to use Fixident and forget it.
To rise above worry and uncertainty,
40 million Americans have placed their trust in the Travelers, its independent insurance agents and brokers, to help provide financial peace of mind. You're better off under the umbrella.
I eat nutritious meals with plenty of fruit and vegetables, so how come I'm the one with painful gas?
Surprise! Foods high in nutrition are often high in gas. But GasX gets rid of the gas, so you feel better fast. Eat right and feel right with GasX.
Many mysteries surround the man who sits tonight in a New Jersey jail. Authorities say he's a mild-mannered, church-going accountant who savagely slaughtered his family. Now there is speculation that he just could be a legendary skyjacker. Richard Schlesinger reports.
They searched and searched.
D.B. Cooper, where are you? It's the question Americans in songs and at festivals have been asking for almost 20 years.
Now, D.B., you clever one, you got them all the rough.
I think it's wonderful, even if he did do it.
In 1971, the middle-aged, nondescript hijacker vanished after parachuting from a passenger jet with $200,000. He landed himself a place in American folklore. When a manhunt failed to turn up any sign of Cooper, people called him a daredevil. They called him a Robin Hood. Now it turns out he just may be this man, identified by police as John List, an especially violent New Jersey accountant. Ralph Himmelsbach was the original FBI agent on the case.
He does come within the ballpark as far as I'm concerned. He appears to be a logical candidate.
This one is not solved, and we're still after D.B. Cooper.
There is nothing romantic about List. Police say one afternoon he killed his family in their Westfield, New Jersey house. While America's love affair with the D.B. Cooper legend ran wild, List was allegedly living a quiet life under a new name, but still working as an accountant. He was arrested after the TV show America's Most Wanted profiled the List murders. There are some tantalizing similarities between the hijacker and the accountant. Pictures of John List in 1971 and the composite drawing of D.B. Cooper look somewhat alike. Both men are said to speak with no noticeable accent. The List murders took place just 15 days before the hijacking, and List abandoned his car at an airport. But in quiet Westfield, New Jersey, List is remembered as hardly the D.B. Cooper type.
Not to be humorous, if I said this was like Kiss from Milk Toast trying to emulate John Wayne.
The accountant police have in custody doesn't even admit he's John List, let alone D.B. Cooper. Prosecutors say they have a lot of evidence against him, but it's all about the murder of the List family. The only thing linking him to hijacking is a lot of fascinating, some say far-fetched, speculation. Richard Schlesinger, CBS News, New York.
And that's the CBS Evening News. I'm Connie Chung in New York, sitting in for Dan Rather. Bob Schieffer will be here tomorrow, and I'll see you again on Sunday. Thank you for joining us and for all of us at CBS News. Good night.
Action continues on CBS Sports with one of the oldest tournaments in the United States, the Beatrice Western Open, tomorrow on CBS Sports.
This is CBS.
Every day I'm with her, I love her more because it's a new experience.